Hi, my name is Sven, welcome back to the channel. Today's video was requested by quite a few people here and it follows up on my videos about color management and gamuts, which you can find linked in the video description. So let's get started. So today we're talking about transfer curves or transfer functions, and you probably already work with them all the time. Transfer functions are essentially lock curves you can set your camera to work with. But there's a bit more to that term, so let's look at the different types of transfer curves. The first ones are the optoelectronic transfer functions, or in short, OETF. They convert linear light to a semi-lock curve. And the other type is the electro-optical transfer function, or in short, EOTF. And they do the opposite, they convert the semi-lock signal to linear. Okay, but what does that mean? So in real life, light scales linearly. And we talked about this a couple of times on my channel already, for example in my video about linear gain. But let's quickly recap. If we set up a dark room with only one candle, and we add a second candle, of course the difference that second candle makes is quite strong. We double the light in this room. However, if there are already 10 candles and we add one more, this additional one does not really make a noticeable difference. So even though in both scenarios we added one candle, the effects this one candle has are quite different. So in order to increase the brightness of the room with the 10 candles to a factor of 2, just as we did with the first room, we would have to add 10 more candles. Double it again and you have to add 20 candles. Again and you have to add 40. So you see where I'm going with this. In an instant, the numbers can get really high. Just beware, we're going through a few more numbers, but it will make sense in a minute. So because light scales linearly, this means that even though the weight of detail in a scene is heavily shifted towards the shadows or lower mid-range, we still get a lot of really high values in the highlights. Now, a camera has a problem recording all of those big values in its internal 10-bit or 12-bit recording. We're not talking about raw photography, but we're talking about the video where it's a bit different. You can't just capture incredibly huge data in a video camera. So 10-bit allows 1024 integer values. For 12-bit, that's 4096. Simply scaling down the light intensity so you can store the bright values in the higher bits would mean the camera doesn't get enough bits for the lower values, the shadows. So what the camera does is it applies a curve to the incoming light before storing it, so all the data can get mapped into a 0 to 1023 range or 0 to 4095 in 12-bit. And usually cameras nowadays use something called a semi-logarithmic curve for that. So what is that? So you might remember the term logarithmic from math class. It's that curve that goes flatter and flatter the more you go to the right. So it's ideal for compressing high input values. And you might also remember that this has one small problem on the left side. You cannot input negative values or zero, and close to zero it outputs values approaching negative infinity. But how is that important? Now, a camera of course only records positive values, and mostly really high ones, right? Well, that's only half of the story. Yes, most of the image can be captured with a pure log curve, but what if the scene is really dark? A log curve would output values approaching negative infinity, but a camera can't store those because 10-bit and 12-bit allow only integer values that are positive. Also, a camera sensor always adds some noise to the image, and this noise can push the incoming values even lower, so they are in fact negative, which, as we said earlier, is not allowed for a logarithmic curve. And that's why cameras apply a semi-log curve. They are modified in a way to deal with those shadow values by splitting the curve in two parts, the logarithmic parts for the main bulk of the image, and a linear extension for the lower shadows and blacks. This way all of the incoming light can be stored in the 10 bits and 12 bits available. And this is what we call the OETF. It converts the optical, so the scene light through the lens, to the electronic, the digital image. The EOTF is just the opposite, it converts the electronic to the optical. For that matter, it's also a curve consisting of two parts, the linear part again for the shadows and blacks, and also an exponential function for everything else, since the exponential function is basically the opposite of the logarithmic function. Okay, that was a lot, let's quickly recap. Because of the linear nature of light, incoming values can get really high. A camera needs to compress those down so it can actually store all this data. For that it uses a log curve, but this one, by nature, can't store negative data, and because of the sensor's noise, this can become a problem. So the log curve is modified with a linear extension to deal with those shadows and blacks, and this modified log curve is the OETF. And in order to revert to the original linear image, an inverse function called EOTF is applied. Now, this applies to cameras, but there are also OETFs and EOTFs for display color spaces and working color spaces. Actually, it's the same thing. However, sometimes it's not based on logarithmic curves, but for example power functions, which we know as gamma curves, but the main idea is the same. And this, by the way, is also the reason why the wording in our beloved color space transform OFX is a bit bad. DaVinci Resolve calls it gamma here, while transfer function would actually be a better term here. Not all the curves in this list are gamma curves, most of them are actually logarithmic, but let's move on. Now, to round it off, let's look at some commonly used OETFs. The first ones in the alphabet are ACES and ARRI. For ACES, we have ACES CC and ACES CCT. The only difference between the two is that ACES CC is a pure logarithmic curve, while ACES CCT adds the T, the toe as it's called here, which is the linear extension. ARRI has log C3 and log C4, and as you can see, log C4 is way flatter, because it is designed to store even larger input values recorded by the newer ARRI cameras. Here we see the curves of S-Log3, Red-Log3G10, F-Log and DaVinci Intermediate as a few examples. And you can see that they are all quite similar, but when we look at all of them side by side, do you notice anything special? Pause the video here to think about it a bit and let me know in the comments below. So, did you get it? The log curves all look similar, sure. But there's one curve here that is different from the others, and it is DaVinci Intermediate. Why? Well, all of those OETFs move the black point to a dark gray color, roughly around 0.09. Each one has their own specific value. DaVinci Intermediate, however, sets the black point to 0, and this, in my opinion, has a really strong advantage for the tools provided in DaVinci Resolve. You see, there are a number of tools that benefit from that because they pivot around this value. So, for example, the gain wheel. Using gain does not affect 0 as it is a multiplication. Multiplying 0 by any number still results in 0. This means that our black point does not move when we brighten the image. And the same is true for gamma, which pivots around 0 and 1. And even the S-curve contrast, when we enable the S-curve here in the project settings, benefits from this, as it applies a smooth roll-off towards black. And the same is true for the custom curves. Now, other log curves that were designed for recording and storing data need to offset the signal a bit, because they need to create some headroom for the noise and dark image detail, and also because of the codecs used in the camera. So because of that, their black points are shifted up a bit, which is not ideal for the color grading tools that are not color space aware. For example, the gain wheel here moves the black point up and down, and the same goes for gamma, etc. And by the way, if you don't know the difference between tools that are color space aware and those that are not, just check out the video linked above. But since DaVinci Intermediate is not a curve designed for capturing data, but for color grading, and it only ever exists in Resolve's internal 32-bit float processing, it can easily work with negative values, so it can easily set the black point to a reasonable value of 0. The only problem here would be if you applied tools that clamp the signal, and when you use render cache with codecs like ProRes, but working with cached files always comes with some degradation in quality, and usually we would not use render cache in a final render anyway.
Hey, thanks for watching. Let me know if you have any more questions about transfer curves, and if you learned something, please leave a like and a comment down below. And make sure you are subscribed to the channel so you don't miss out on upcoming episodes. So that's it for today. I will see you in the next video.